I am a practitioner of science. My name is Samuel Conway, and I have a doctorate in chemistry from Dartmouth. I would like to present right now for what I hope will be both your entertainment as well as enlightenment, something I call science, pseudoscience, and outright crap, specifically because someone watching this right now is wearing a magnet and you think it's doing something for you. Allow me to begin by presenting what I call the continuum of human understanding. On the left extreme, we have what we call science, the rational, the measurable, the observable, the reproducible. On the far right extreme, we have magic, mysticism, tooth fairies, sorry kids, things that we collectively refer to as crap. Now, usually it's easy to tell these two things apart because they are separated by that gulf. But what about that bit in the middle where that line comes? What happens when you take the trappings of science and use them to dress up crap? We get something that we call pseudoscience. It is when you take something that is completely nonsensical and try to use scientific language and other smoke and mirrors, sciencey sounding things, to sell it to people. I have an example here, which we will be discussing at length later in the presentation. This is nothing new. Pseudoscience goes back a long way. These ads go back to the 50s and 60s. See what they say? Science discovered it. No unpleasant aftertaste. Buy our cigarettes, because this man, who's obviously a scientist, he's looking into his binocular microscope, just like a scientist should, and he's smoking in the lab, just like scientists do. And on the right, we've got scientific evidence on the effects of smoking by some guy with a signature. See it? Science, 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 science. It must be true. It's science, and we know that science is truth, right? Only in the right hands. Please consider the following two statements. Take this magic charm that contains mystical powers that will make all your pain vanish forever. Compare that to, this clinically tested device can reduce pain up to 98% by realigning the natural electromagnetic impulses of red blood cells, thus improving circulation. These are the exact same statement. By the way, the one on the bottom is not a joke. I actually found that claim being made by a gadget we'll talk about in just a moment. These two sentences say the exact same thing. But people aren't generally going to believe the one on top, but they're more likely to believe the one on the bottom because it's all sciencey sounding. Here we have the Norso brand Pro Magnet. It's used by a NFL professional football team. Look at how they try to blind you with science. That would make a great name for a song now that I think about it. They try to blind you with science to sell you on their gadget here. How magnets work. Here we have an artery carrying blood to the heart. Well, first and foremost, that's not how it works. We're going to surround that artery with powerful magnets. And without a magnetic field, your red blood cells, they're just everywhere, chaotic, bumping into each other. But you apply a magnetic field and they all line up like good little soldiers and they become much better at carrying oxygen. No, that's not how it works. That's not how anything works. Your blood does contain iron in the form of hemoglobin, but it is not magnetic iron. If it was, if this diagram were correct, anytime you went through a metal detector at the airport, you would flush bright red as all your blood cells were sucked to the surface of your skin. Magnets have no effect on human blood cells. But that doesn't stop people from selling them, and they've been doing it a long time, from centuries and decades and minutes and hours ago. We have Dr. Weltmer. He has cured 100,000 people by waving magnets over them, and he'll teach his art to you for a fee. And on right, Physicians recommend the Wilsonian magnetic corsets for day and night wear on account of their curative properties. It's a corset which is infused with magnets, a series of magnets scientifically arranged for minute batteries. No, they don't. No, they don't. It doesn't work like that. Nothing works like that. They don't charge the blood with magnetism. They don't furnish a wonderful remedy for these things. And the effect is not exhilarating to the wearer. The only thing this would be good for would be a comedy routine for when this lady walks in front of a refrigerator. I would love to see that. Here's your first take-home lesson. Magnets are not medicine. Since time immemorial, anytime humanity has discovered some new force of nature, some new energy with which we had previously been unfamiliar, right away, the crooks, the charlatans, the mountebanks, the quacks, they are hot on the heels of the scientists, screaming to people, this must be a cure-all. It's a mystic energy of the universe. It has to cure you. Because since this is a poorly understood force, they're banking on the fact that people are not going to know to question them when they say, yes, this will cure everything in the world. Here's another mystical force that was discovered that people immediately claimed would treat gout, rheumatism, arthritis, neuralgia, sciatica, tabes dorsalis, catarrh of the antrum, arteriosclerosis, diabetes, glycosuria, nephritis. My goodness, these are all vastly different conditions. They are not at all related to each other. Gout is caused by something very different from rheumatism, which is caused by something very different from sciatica, which is caused by something very different from catarrh of the antrum, which, by the way, is a stuffy nose. And the causes of a stuffy nose are very, very different from the causes of diabetes. But here is this amazing new energy that is being hawked by people. This will cure everything. It is the panacea. What could this incredible cure-all be? What could this miraculous gift from heaven for the betterment of mankind be? Why, my friends, nothing less than the amazing curative powers of radioactivity. This apparatus gives a high and measured dosage of radioactive drinking water. This is what a common one looked like. The one on the right is the Revigator. It's a clay pot that has been lined with uranium ore. The idea is you would fill it with water. The water would absorb the wonderful curative radioactivity, and then you would pour a teacup out of that little spigot at the bottom. And you would drink it, and it would cure your arthritis, your neuralgia, your sciatica, etc., etc., etc. That should be your first clue. Nothing cures multiple unrelated conditions. We know what most diseases are caused by these days. We can point to this factor, for most of them, this factor is causing the condition, and we can then target that factor. Nothing in the world is going to cure your stuffy nose and your tabes dorsalis, whatever the heck that is, and your diabetes at the same time, because nothing is going to affect those very different biological mechanisms. I came across an interesting story. An advertisement was sent to a gentleman named Samuel Clemens in the late 19th century. He wrote under the name Mark Twain, an author that I have greatly admired. He received this ad for the Elixir of Life, and it said that it could cure bronchitis, mumps, measles, hemorrhage, tapeworm, eczema, influenza, throat disease, oak poison, tumors of the body, cerebrospinal meningitis, dandruff, corns and bunions, appendicitis, and diabetes, dysentery, dyspepsia, and diarrhea, which must be related because they all start with the same letter. Well, Mr. Twain was not in a very good mood when he got this. He read it and he was outraged. He immediately shot off a letter to the people that had sent him this amazing ad. handwriting might be a little bit hard to make out, but I'll draw your attention to my favorite part of it, his conclusion. The person that wrote that advertisement is without doubt the most ignorant person alive on the planet. Also without doubt, he is an idiot of the 33rd degree, and scion of an ancestral procession of idiots stretching back to the missing link. Mr. Twain was a very intelligent man. Even he understood that there is no single agent out there that is going to cure every ill known to man. This is pseudoscience. They tried to paint it in scientific terms, but it was crap, and Mr. Twain knew it. Now, nowhere has science been more bastardized, more perverted than the field of human vanity. Human beings, particularly the male of the species, has been terrified of baldness for centuries. And they have had no hope until 1923, when the thermocap came out. Here we've got Professor Conehead wearing his thermocap on the right. The idea was that this would deliver infrared radiation, a poorly understood by the general public force of nature, to the scalp, and this magical infrared radiation would cause hair to grow because it's magical. Infrared radiation is known as heat. This is basically a hot cap. You put it on your head and it gets hot. And if you'll excuse me, that plug on the left, that terrifies me. This thing looks like an execution device. But heating up your scalp does not energize your hair follicles and make them grow. It just doesn't happen. Well, people bought thousands of these, wasted their money, and when they found out, they went looking for Professor Conehead there, but he had already skipped town. He'd gone to Argentina with his millions and was living on a beach. So the poor balding fellas miserably waited until 1939 and the arrival of the Crosley Cervac, which was available to them in a home model that they could rent. The Crosley Cervac used another natural force. It was a vacuum helmet. You would apply this vacuum helmet to your head, and you would turn it on, and I guess it would suck the hair out of your scalp and make it look fuller or something. I don't know. They explained it in the ad. You could read it yourself. Guess what? It didn't work either. The only thing it did was give a bunch of bald men head hickeys. Well, the bald men went looking for this guy, Mr. Crosley, but he had skipped town. He was living with Professor Thermocap there down in Argentina, and they were laughing at everyone. So the poor balding men had to wait until 2013, when the magical Theradome laser helmet came on the market. Well, if infrared radiation didn't work and vacuum didn't work, surely lasers will work. Oh, let's see what the Theradome laser helmet has. It's got a master switch. All good laser helmets should have a master switch. It's got built-in speakers, so it can talk to you, I guess. It's got proximity sensors. Never buy a laser helmet that does not have proximity sensors. Look at all these other features that it has. But let me draw your attention to that big blaring headline up there, FDA cleared. You'll see that a lot, FDA cleared, especially in the world of late 2020 when this presentation is being given. FDA cleared is being bandied about quite a lot. What does FDA cleared mean? Does it mean that this works? No. FDA cleared does not mean FDA approved. These are very, very different statements. FDA cleared has a specific meaning, and that meaning is the FDA has looked at this and is pretty certain it will not kill you. That is exactly what FDA cleared means. You can go ahead and use it because it probably won't kill you. That doesn't mean FDA approved. There's another thing you're going to see a lot. This is my favorite one. Clinically tested. Clinically tested. Clinically tested. Clinically tested. Clinically tested. Clinically tested. That's great. What were the results of the test? We tested it. It's in the clinic. It's clinically tested. Clinically tested does not mean clinically proven. You should be very, very careful anytime you see an advertisement. Remember, the first thing you need to watch out for is it claiming it cures multiple conditions that are not related to each other? Look very, very carefully then at the exact claim. What are they promising you? If they only promise that they tested it, full stop, then they're hiding something. Maybe they tested it and it didn't work. They can still sell it as long as they tell you, we tested it. I looked into the Theradone laser helmet, some of the advertising copy here. You can read this at your own pace, but I do want to draw your attention to the specific claims, to the promises that they make you. It's all sciencey sounding language. It sounds so promising, doesn't it? But what are they offering? Hair loss might soon be a thing of the past. It seems that they might have found the cure for thinning locks. Apparently, it's been proven to grow new hair by presumably brilliant people. I was finished with this slide and was about to go on when my eye fell on this statement. You remember how in the last slide it was FDA cleared? Now suddenly it's FDA approved. How did that happen? Well, that happened through a little bit of subterfuge. The FDA, that's the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, if you were not aware, came up with a means for drug products and medical devices to get to market faster without going through the long, tedious registration process. If you are putting something out that is substantially similar to something already on the market, all you have to do is prove that yours is the same as theirs. Aspirin, for example. We already know that aspirin is safe. We know it's effective. We know the dosage. You don't have to go and reprove all of that. If you want to market an aspirin, you just have to show that your aspirin is substantially similar or substantially equivalent to aspirin on the market, also known as the predicate material or the predicate device. In the case of the Theradome laser helmet, the predicate device is a giant multi-billion dollar laser that takes a whole team of technicians to operate and must be very, very carefully administered by a talented scientific professional. It has shown promise in treating a single type of baldness, androgenic alopecia. And that is the only thing that it has shown promise for, and it doesn't cure it, it just makes it a little less bad. So, yeah, a certain kind of laser can help a certain kind of baldness. So, here they come with the Theradome laser helmet, and they say, oh, we're going to show that ours is substantially the same. Here's their claim. It has the same intended use as the multi-billion dollar laser. In other words, we want to use it to treat baldness. It has the same indications. We're going to aim a laser at your head. Oh, it has treatment to the entire scalp, just like the multi-billion dollar. And it's got the same treatment schedule. For those reasons, see that down there? For those reasons, and those reasons only, it satisfies the FDA's substantial equivalence. Well, the FDA kind of grumbled and said, well, it does. That's not exactly what we intended when we wrote the law. But crooks don't care. They'll find a way around it. This gives them the opportunity to say the Theradome laser helmet is FDA approved because it is substantially equivalent to the giant multi-billion dollar laser. They're just quietly not going to tell you how it's equivalent. Let's go back to this gentleman, Dr. Mehmet Oz. I apologize. I've been having trouble with my PowerPoint. It keeps bringing graphics from earlier in the program. I'll fix it later, so I apologize for that. Garcinia cambogia is an extract of a mystical plant that grows in Cameroon, and this was being hawked as as the holy grail of diet pills. It could allow you to eat anything you wanted to, and you wouldn't gain weight. Take a Garcinia Cambogia pill, and you can stuff yourself with cheeseburgers and milkshakes and French fries, and you wouldn't gain any weight. A magic pill that allows you to keep weight off, remain beautiful, without working, without dieting, without exercising, without any effort. You don't have to do anything. Take the magic pill and you'll lose weight. I had to look into this one. Dr. Oz explained how Garcinia Cambogia works. Well, it increases the levels of serotonin in the body. Now, if you have ever taken an antidepressant, you might be familiar with serotonin. Serotonin is a chemical in the human brain that regulates mood. And if it gets out of whack, if your serotonin levels are off, it can have some very dramatic effects on mood. So you've got this pill that you're going to be taking at home without the care and observation of a physician that is going to be screwing with your serotonin levels. You run the danger of manic episodes. You run the danger of suicide. You run the danger of rampant depression. What else does it do here? it blocks the enzyme citrate lyase, provides instructions to the body to create the fats from carbohydrates. How sciencey. Isn't that sciencey? That sounds so intellectual. It must be true. He's using such big words. Well, we scientists have our own version of Google. It's called PubMed. I started looking into some of the actual research that was done on Garcinia Cambogia. First off, the paper that Dr. Oz was basing his claims off of apparently has been debunked several times. It involved only 8 patients in Cameroon, could not be reproduced. But here we had an honest effort from a group of South Korean researchers. Okay, we think it's crap, but we are scientists. We cannot dismiss it out of hand. Let's test it and see if it works. So they did. They tested Garcinia Cambogia. And what were the results? I'll skip to the punchline here. It does work. It actually works. It protects against high-fat diet-induced obesity, but it induces hepatic fibrosis, inflammation, and oxidative stress. That's how it makes you skinny. It poisons you. It actually has toxic effects. No wonder you don't put weight on. If it is too good to be true, it's not. And we've been telling people that for generations, but people still buy this stuff. If you see something and you go, wow, that's too good to be true, it's not. Now, I was very, very curious. Dr. Oz is an actual physician. How could a man of medicine who presumably has sworn by the Hippocratic Oath, how could he hawk this material which is toxic, which will cause harm to the person who takes it simply for the vanity of being thin? Unless maybe he knows that it doesn't actually contain any Garcinia Cambogia. Well, that's one possible explanation. I wasn't the only one to have this question. Dr. Oz was dragged up in front of Congress and had to do a lot of backpedaling about his claims. And suddenly, Garcinia Cambogia wasn't the miracle that he had previously suggested that it was. Dr. Oz, we salute you. I've spent enough time with Dr. Oz. I don't mean to slam the man. I'm certain that he has his good points. I just haven't yet found any. This is America. I am still entitled to my opinion. And my opinion of Dr. Oz is that he can be described by a number of phrases which admittedly are not flattering. This is my personal and professional opinion. However, there is one word that I will not apply to Dr. Oz. That word I reserve for this man here. This man is named Andrew Wakefield. And the name that I have for him is Monster. Let me tell you a story. In 1998, The Lancet, one of the most prestigious medical journals in the world, published a paper that raised concern between autism, evidenced by autistic colitis, and the measles, mumps, rubella vaccine, a combination vaccine that had been given to millions of children worldwide and was very, very effective, very, very well tolerated, generally considered to be extremely safe, and had come within a hair's breadth of completely eradicating measles, followed by mumps and rubella, just as we had eradicated smallpox by the application of the vaccine. We vaccinated enough people that smallpox went extinct. And getting rid of measles would be a wonderful thing because it's a nasty disease. It's not a cute childhood disease. It cripples, it deafens, it kills children. But Wakefield said that he had found a link between the MMR vaccine and developmental regression in a group of previously normal children, a bunch of children who were perfectly healthy and happy. They received this combination vaccine and bang, suddenly they were autistic. Even before the paper came out in print, he gave a news conference that said, "We have got to stop using this vaccine. It's causing children to be autistic." What was the result? You can predict what the result was. People went nuts. They started screaming, yelling, beating their heads against the floor. "Oh, no, no, we can't. No vaccines. No vaccines are causing autism. They were dreamed up by evil scientists at evil pharmaceutical corporations who want your children to be autistic." Yeah, right. Sure, we do. What was the outcome? Vaccination rates in the UK dropped from about 93% and nearly eradicating measles to about 73%, some measured as low as 50% in the city of London, and measles came roaring back, almost gone and now everywhere. Mumps came roaring back in Chicago, Nova Scotia. 2008, measles was running rampant in the United States. One outbreak in San Francisco they were able to trace to a single child whose parents had deliberately not vaccinated the child. 2011, 26 cases in a single county. And my favorite, in December of 2014, the sickest place on earth, the now famous measles outbreak at Disneyland. Somebody brought in unvaccinated children, other unvaccinated children got it, and it just went crazy. Well, people believed that vaccines caused autism, so they stopped vaccinating their children. Immediately, the rate of measles infection skyrocketed, the rate of rubella infection skyrocketed, the rate of mumps infection skyrocketed, but there was no effect on the rate of autism. You stopped vaccinating children, and the diseases the vaccines are designed to cure just went wild in the population, but it didn't affect the rate of autism. You would think that that would be a pretty big piece of evidence that says maybe it wasn't the vaccines. Incidentally, I am going to slip a little statement in here right now, intended for parents who do not want to vaccinate their children because they are afraid it will make their children autistic. Parents, these diseases can kill your child. What you are saying to me is, I would rather my child be dead than developmentally disabled. My, what a terrible thing for your life that your child be developmentally disabled. Let's let the child die instead. Fuck you. Let's move on, shall we? I believe it was a matter of timing. Follow me now. 1998, The Lancet published that paper. Ooh, MMR vaccine causes autism. It was a year and a half before that that Dr. Wakefield was granted almost £500,000 by a group of lawyers who wanted to sue the manufacturers of the MMR vaccine. In other words, they, lawyers, had come to the conclusion the vaccine was harmful, and they went to Wakefield and gave him a ton of money and said, find us some evidence that it's harmful. Well, it was July, August, September, what, a couple of months later after getting this money. I'm sure he had barely started his research when he published this paper to a group of very, very rich investors. And you can find copies of this paper on the internet today if you look. He wanted to start a company, and he was going to call it Carmel Healthcare to market diagnostic tests. He wanted to sell these test kits to parents that they could use at home. Use this test kit. It will tell you if your child has been poisoned by the vaccine. He stated that in view of the unique services offered, the assays can command premium prices. The market will be litigation-driven testing. There will be political legal pressures, and the demand will be enormous. In other words, we're going to destroy public confidence in the MMR vaccine. And when people stampede into the courts, we're going to be sitting right there with our test kits here. They're expensive, but you're going to need it for your case. Let me continue with my examination of the timing. Remember, all of this happened in between 1996 and 1998, February. In June of 1998, only a few months after the paper came out in print, the ink wasn't even dry. Wakefield applied for a patent for a replacement MMR vaccine. He even said in the patent application that the use of the vaccine does result in pervasive developmental disorder, including autism, in some infants. He made that statement. Let me paraphrase for you. Now that we have completely destroyed public confidence in the MMR vaccine, I am going to release my own vaccine that I control and get all the money for. Well, as you can imagine, people started looking into his claims, and they very, very quickly began to realize that those claims were nonsense. First off, there were only 12 children in his study. N equals 12 does not a study make. And it was shown, it was demonstrated that a significant percentage of those children were showing signs of developmental regression before they got the vaccine. So, no, they were not previously normal children. They were children who were showing signs of autism, who then got the vaccine and continued showing signs of autism. Well, this, of course, blew up in his face. In 2001, he had to resign his hospital post because he said he was unpopular. In 2010, The Lancet actually retracted the original paper, stating that the claims had been proven to be false. Not just questioning them, they've been proven to be false. He was stripped of his academic credentials, stripped of his medical license. The British Medical Journal lambasted him using phrases like falsification of data, fraud. Was he incompetent? No. A great deal of thought and effort must have gone into drafting the paper to achieve the results he wanted. There are no simple answers. I wish there were. Autism is a very, very complex condition. It might have genetic components. It might have environmental components. It might be some combination of the two. We don't know. We're still trying to figure it out. What we do know is what does not cause autism. We can demonstrate vaccines do not cause autism. We can prove vaccines do not cause autism. So as you can imagine, Dr. Wakefield was driven into hiding. He was run out of town on a fence rail, had to change his name. Boy, don't I wish. Actually, it was quite the opposite. There are still children out there who lionize this man. They treat him as a hero. And he's being crucified by Big Pharma. Those evil pharmaceutical corporations are cooking up charges against him because they're evil and he's a great man and they're just trying to silence him. Despite the mountains of evidence, literal mountains of evidence that I can drop on your head that prove beyond any doubt whatsoever that vaccines do not cause autism. These people still jump on this very, very dodgy fellow and cling to what he says. Why is that? Are these people stupid? One could argue it. I don't believe they are. Because human beings are susceptible to something we call confirmation bias. That is an overwhelming desire to latch on to data that supports what you believe and to completely discount data that does not support what you believe. So these people simply just don't even pay attention to the data I show them. They only see the data that supports what they believe. It's a sad state of affairs. Even scientists are susceptible to confirmation bias. It is something we must fight against on a daily basis. Fortunately, we are trained to do so. Let's move on, shall we? Here's a package that I found when I was flying to Australia. I was flying through New Zealand, or as they say down there, New Zealand. And I saw this stuff, and I had to look closer. No jet lag. It's designed to I guess, alleviate the symptoms of jet lag, which, according to this package, are weariness, you're overly tired, but apparently jet lag also causes nausea, upset stomach. I've traveled a lot. I get tired. I've never had upset stomach, but let's go with that. Let's assume that this is a therapeutic agent to treat both exhaustion and tummy troubles. So I'm going to draw your attention to that little word right there. Homeopathic. Everybody knows what homeopathic means, or do they? You might think you do, but the chances are you don't. Let me enlighten you, if I may. By the way, remember I told you always look at the promise. What exactly are they selling you? Guaranteed to help you cope. It's not going to cure you. It's not going to treat you. It will help you cope. This gentleman is Dr. Samuel Hahnemann, who lived in what is now Germany in the 1700s, and who apparently could have benefited from the Theradome laser helmet. In the late 1700s, he became very, very fascinated with this little plant, the cinchona plant, or cinchona, or cinchona. I'll have to look it up someday. This plant. And he discovered that there were natives in the New World who were using an extract of this plant to treat malaria. Well, let's look at the cinchona bark, which is what they were using. They would use it against malaria. Now, malaria is a very, very uncomfortable disease. It gives you fever, tremors, joint pain, sweating. Well, Dr. Hahnemann, being a good natural philosopher, got his hands on some of this cinchona bark, and he, I guess, gnawed on it for a while and made tea out of it, I don't know. And in very, very short order, he started to experience fever, tremors, joint pain, and sweating. Well, this stuff is supposed to cure fever, tremors, joint pain, and sweating. But when he took it, he developed fever, tremors, joint pain, and sweating. I have discovered the law of similars. If something causes a symptom in a healthy person, it will cure that same symptom in a person who already exhibits it. Hence, homeopathy. You know, same disease. You can cure a condition by giving somebody something that causes the condition. For example, if you have stinging, swelling, and redness, you should put some bee venom on it because bee venom causes stinging, swelling, and redness. If you have itching, you should put some poison ivy on it because poison ivy causes itching. If you have asthma, trouble breathing, you should take some arsenic because arsenic makes you stop breathing. Guess what? This is actually prescribed by the homeopathetic people for... anyway. Okay. I'm going to put poison ivy on you. I'm going to give you arsenic. Well, most rational people are going to back off and say, no, you're not. That stuff's pretty awful. I'll live with the asthma. I'll live with the itching. So Dr. Hahnemann decided, well, maybe if we diluted it down, we can't give somebody concentrated arsenic. Let's dilute that arsenic so that it will not have a harmful effect. But how far can we dilute it? Well, I don't know if Dr. Hahnemann had ever read a paper by this gentleman who apparently could have benefited from some Garcinia cambogia. This gentleman is known today by the name Paracelsus. Paracelsus was sitting around drinking with some friends one day, and he came up with this drunken notion that he's like, okay, guys, you're gonna like this. Okay, wait. Everything's poison. It just depends on how much you get. So he wrote that down. All things are poisons, for there is nothing without poisonous qualities. It's only the dose which makes a thing a poison. We call that today toxicology. The theory of toxicology, which we attribute to Paracelsus, that everything out there, if you get enough of it, will poison you. And if you get a smaller dose, it will not. We have taken that to the next step. We can predict, based on our experiments, if you take a tiny amount of something, it won't have any effect on the body. If you take a certain amount more, it'll have a beneficial effect, such as aspirin. If you take too much of it, then it becomes a poison. That is toxicology. Let's look at no jet lag. I had to look at the label and see what this had in it. Let's see, it has Arnica montana, which contains a toxin known as helenolin. That produces severe gastroenteritis. It gives you a huge tummy ache. Well, remember, one of the symptoms of jet lag is nausea, so if this causes it, it should cure it, right? It contains a ipecacuanha, which contains two alkaloids, emetine and cephaline. They're both strong emetics. If you don't know what that means, it means they make you barf. It contains lycopodium, which contains huperzine A. That also produces severe gastroenteritis. And it's got daisies and chamomiles. They're just freaking flowers. I don't know what the hell they're in there for. But see those 30C? After each one, 30C, 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 you will see that all the time in the homeopathic lexicon. What does 30C mean? Well, to the homeopaths, C is a dilution factor. It's a dilution of 1 in 100. So if I take one drop of, shall we say, helenolin, and I put it in 100 drops of water, that's 1C. I've diluted it by about 100. Now, if I take that solution, and I dilute it in 100 parts of water, that's 2C. I've now gone from one part in 100 to one part in 10,000. If I take one drop of that and dilute it in 100 parts, that is now 3C. It is now one part in 1 million. Everybody follow that? Good. So what does that mean for 30C? 30C means you have one part of your ingredient in 1,000 million, billion, 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 1 novemdecillion parts. One part in 1 novemdecillion parts of diluent. And since we have a tablet here and you're no jet lag, your diluent is sugar. So you've dispersed one part in 1 novemdecillion parts of sugar. Okay, here's a little intellectual exercise. I love to do this live. If I wanted to take a grain of salt and I wanted to make a tablet that contained that grain of salt to 30C, in other words, my tablet contained 1 grain of salt in 1 novemdecillion parts of tablet, how big would that tablet be? Would that tablet be the size of a swimming pool? Would the tablet be the size of a skyscraper? Would that tablet be the size of the state of Delaware? Would it be the size of planet Earth? That tablet, if you calculate it, based on a 1 square millimeter grain of salt, your tablet would be 134 trillion kilometers in diameter. That is 18,000 times the distance from our sun to Pluto. That distance, by the way, is about 7 billion kilometers. For those of you who like math, we're talking about a tablet that is 4 parsecs, approximately 12 light years in diameter. For comparison, the nearest star, Alpha Centauri, it's only about 1.3 parsecs away. That is a big tablet. Okay, maybe that was too much. Maybe that wasn't fair. 1 square millimeter. What if I wanted just one molecule? One single molecule. This is helenolin or cephalin. I can't remember which one I put up there. I want to have one novemdecillionth part of this molecule in a tablet. I want this molecule at 30 C in a tablet. Now, that is the smallest unit you can get. You can't get any smaller than one molecule. Well, the tablet, if you do the calculation, is not going to be as big as 4 parsecs, but it is still going to be 18 billion times the weight of planet Earth, just to get a single molecule. Here is an actual homeopathetic material, belladonna at 30 C. The chances of actually encountering a molecule of anything in there are very, very small, because these tablets are not much bigger than the weight of the Earth. As a matter of fact, they're far smaller. This contains belladonna, which is known as deadly nightshade. It is deadly because it contains some very, very nasty things like atropine, scopolamine, and hyoscyamine. What do they do? Well, if you get these into you, they will cause sweating, flushed skin, tachycardia, that's a fast heartbeat, fever, and delirium. Just think of somebody being poisoned by belladonna in old detective novels. They die horribly. But you can buy a belladonna 30C tablet to treat fever with sweating, because it causes sweating and fever. So if you take a diluted quantity that is now so diluted it doesn't exist, it should treat fever and sweating. Well, that's at 30C. What about this one? 200. Ignore the K. That's just more homeopathic crap they're throwing in there. 200 C. This is one part in 10 to 200. I can't tell you. I tried to calculate how big the tablet would be. Microsoft Excel choked on it. It can't do numbers that big. What I can tell you is that to get 200 C of any molecule in a tablet, the size of the tablet will exceed the total theoretical number of molecules in the known universe. In that tablet, is there any belladonna? No. It's a sugar pill. It's all that it has in it. But people say, but it works, it works. It doesn't have any belladonna. You've diluted it out. It's gone. There's nothing in there. But it works. How could it work? Remember I mentioned confirmation bias? And even scientists can be susceptible to it. There was a scientist who decided that it was already gospel that it does work. So he started looking for a reason. And when you start with a conclusion and then try to backtrack to justify it, sometimes things can get a little weird. This is Jacques Benveniste, who passed away, unfortunately, in 2004. He stated that the structure of biochemicals can be impressed on water. The water will display some of the activity of the original biochemical. What that means is that if you have a biochemical dissolved in water, it's not the biochemical itself that has the health benefit. The biochemical leaves behind a hole in the water that is shaped like that biochemical, and it's that hole in the water that has the health benefit. You don't need the biochemical, you just need the hole it leaves behind. In this case, the addition of the prior graphic was intentional. Now, I've given this talk before, and I've been criticized, rightly so. A fellow scientist said, "I didn't like your talk." I said, "Why?" And he said, "Well, you spent a lot of energy simply criticizing and making fun of homeopathy. You did not present any evidence to the contrary." And he was right, and I was actually quite ashamed. So I'm going to do it now. Why homeopathy is crap. Number one, it's based on a fundamental lack of understanding about the nature of disease. In the 1700s, they didn't know what viruses were. They didn't know what germs were. They didn't know about bacteria. They didn't know about parasites. They didn't even know how the immune system worked. They believed that disease is a manifestation of like an evil spirit, the miasma theory, that there was bad air, and the bad air causes disease. And disease was caused by your body's humors being out of balance. And all you have to do is balance the body's humors by opposite effects. As I said, they had no concept of what causes disease. They believed that disease was entirely a collection of symptoms. They didn't even have a concept of cause. They felt that as long as you treated the symptoms, you were treating the disease. We now know that that is not true. Number two, very simply, if the theory of infinitesimals is true, then everything is homeopathic. I will give you a glass of water. It contains homeopathic quantities of every known material in the universe. You already have it. Why should you pay for it? Just open a tap. It is contrary to the dose-response relationship, which I discussed back when I talked about Paracelsus. That is measurable. It is reproducible. We can demonstrate that that works again and again and again and again. Also, guys, water's a liquid. It doesn't hold shape. And even if it did, your tablet is made out of sugar. I could go on. I could go on. But I only have limited time. People say, oh, maybe it's a placebo effect. Can it be a placebo effect? Actually, it's entirely possible. Like I've told people who believe in this stuff, if it works for you, that's great. The placebo effect is real. You can actually convince your brain that something is working. It only works for pain, though. It only works to reduce pain because pain is a sensation. Our brain can convince itself that it's not sensing that pain anymore. If you think the placebo effect works for other things, try it the next time you have diarrhea, and let me know how well that works. Let me give you a homeopathic birth control pill. Let me know how that placebo effect works for you there. Something else about the placebo effect that is very, very important: it only works if you're the one that's believing it. I've seen this stuff in the stores. Infant earache drops that are homeopathic. Your child is crying and in pain. Here, put this water in his ear. The parent will believe that the child feels better, but the child's still in pain. Oh, let's put some water in your cat and dog. You will believe your dog looks like he feels better, but he's still in just as much pain. He's still just as sick. This is called abuse. Please do not do it when I'm around. But it works. Oh, okay, great. So it works. These homeopathic products are not regulated by the Food and Drug Administration. They could have anything in it. And remember, these people are crooks. They'll put anything on the label they want to. They don't care. Why should a crook care whether he's telling the truth or not? They could put something in there that is an actual active ingredient to make you think that you're Belladonna is working. The FDA, as of when I made this presentation, they had identified 287 weight loss products that were sold as herbal and homeopathic, which contain sibutramine, which is a banned weight loss product. It's an amphetamine that actually has some very serious toxic side effects. You're not allowed to use it anymore. These people who put it in the pill, if it kills you, they don't care. They got your money. They contain Prozac, phenylethylamine. Phenylethylamine used to be sold as X-lax. It makes you go. Yeah, you're going to lose weight. You're going to crap it all out. They had identified more than 320 herbal and homeopathic sexual enhancement products. You know, tiger penis or whatever, or you know, lightning flower, that when they analyzed them, they actually found they contained sildenafil, which is Viagra, and tadalafil, which is Cialis. So they actually had active ingredients in them, even though they said these are herbal, homeopathic, they're safe, they're natural. No, they're not safe. They're not natural. You need a prescription for these things because a doctor has to monitor you while you're taking them. But safe and natural doesn't mean anything to a criminal or a liar. Here's a typical homeopathic advertisement. You can tell it's science-y. It's pseudoscience. Because we have, bioscience, lipid drill, sciencey-sounding words. Here we've got a man who's obviously a doctor because he's wearing a lab coat and has slung his stethoscope, you know, casually around his neck. This is what they use. This is pseudoscience in its purest form. They are selling you snake oil. They are selling you crap. They are selling you dirt they dug up out of the backyard. But they slap these scientific words and images on it, and people buy it by the millions. Is this harmful? Does it really hurt anybody when you separate a fool and his money? One could argue that there's no real victim. It's possible that somebody could put their faith in a homeopathic product and then lose their health or their life because they did not get actual medical care. But a lot of people will simply dismiss it and say, well, it's harmless. I don't believe so. Here's a quote. It goes back to 1947, a man named Vili Lang. When things get so tough, there seems to be no way out. The Russian embraces the vodka bottle, the Frenchman a woman, and the American the Bible. The German tends to resort to magic, to some nonsensical belief which he tries to validate by way of hysterics and physical force. It was the willingness of a noticeable proportion of the Germans to rate rhetoric above research and intuition above knowledge that brought to power a political party which was frankly and loudly anti-intellectual. The Nazis not only burned books they disliked, they also classified theoretical physicists with Jews and Marxists. Anti-intellectualism leads down to a very dark path. And if you have a political force that is screaming anti-intellectualism, you are in for some very dark times. Fortunately, we live in the United States of America, at least I do, and there is no way that could happen here. Thank you very much for your kind attention. You can email me. My email is all over the internet. Just look for it. If you have any questions, if you want to bring up Godwin's law because I mentioned Nazis, you broke Godwin's law. First off, that only works for an online discussion, and it does come from a legitimate source. It's appropriate to the current discussion, so screw you. I'm out of here. Bye.